so thanks very much. So our project at the University of Aberdeen is looking at a key transition in Scottish prehistory and early history in terms of the emergence of the first kingdoms in northern Britain. In particular, we're looking at the Pictish kingdoms within northern Scotland. And we're looking at two areas in particular. One is Kay, which is probably equivalent to modern Aberdeenshire, and Fortru. Fortru seems to be the most powerful Pictish kingdom and was always thought to be located in central Scotland, but recently the historian Alex Wolfe has pinpointed it actually within the Moray Firth region. So we're looking at the archaeology of these two areas, which has been relatively unexplored in the past. And we're looking at lots of different sites, so I won't be able to tell you about all these today. I normally talk about this for an hour, so I'm going to compress this into 20 minutes, or try to at least. So we're working on sites from the Tarbert Peninsula, down Loch Ness, all the way to our Northern Picts Evil Lair in Aberdeen here. So lots of sites I can come back and tell you about another time. I'm going to focus on three sites in particular, three fortified sites, and they are important because they seem to underpin the emergence of kingship in the early medieval period. So we get amongst the few references that we have for what is a fairly poorly documented period is the reference to fortified sites and their link to kings and kingship in this time period. So, you know, when did these re-emerge after a hiatus largely in the Roman Iron Age when these forts don't get constructed? And also trying to understand these things, which are probably the most famous elements of the Picts, their carved stones. So all the sites today we'll be talking about is trying to understand the context of these monuments, these Pictish class one stones, which again are clearly associated with emergence of more hierarchical societies. So for example, on this later stone here from Dunfermline, you can see high status people on thrones, probably marked by these symbols, and also some on horseback, and also other trappings of kingship in this time period, metalworking with tongs, hammer and anvil. So trying to understand these two elements is one important part of our project. This is our first site here that I'm going to talk to you about today, which is Dunacair. It's here on the sea stack, so a bit of extreme archaeology. I apologise for using that term. So this was us springtime last year going to investigate the sea stack site. So why were we doing that? I don't know, it's a bit crazy. I had a lot of bad dreams that week when we did this work. The reason is that this site is very close to Dun Otter Castle. I'm sure a lot of you visited this spectacular castle, which is just in the next bay from Dunacair. And this clearly became an important Pictish site. It's mentioned quite a number of times in the early sources, being under siege, for example, in AD 694. But perhaps there's an earlier site just along the coast here prior to when Dun Otter really takes off, and this is Dunacair. The reason we suspected that is because we had a number of Pictish stones from the site, five in total. And these are really quite rough and ready compared to some of the, you know, fantastically beautiful stones you'll see later on from other sites. So they've always thought to be a bit weird, or perhaps early in the sequence. And they were found in 1832 by a bunch of youths from Stonehaven who went up to the sea stack at great danger to themselves because they were talking to the local gravedigger who said that he had dreams that there was gold buried on top of the sea stack. Okay, so they went up, a bunch of youths from Stonehaven, didn't find any gold, much to their disappointment. What they did find was a low stone wall around the sea stack, and they found the stones, and being youths of the day, they threw them into the sea. And it was only in the next decades that they were recovered and people understood what they were, these fantastic early Pictish stones. So we went up to investigate. You know, very few people had been up to the site since the 19th century discovery. It's now cut off by high tide, so we had to zip side across, climb up to the sea stack, and this is what it looks like on top. It's only about 15 metres across today. We think it was probably a promontory rather than a sea stack in Pictish period, but may well have even been eroding in that period. And what we found was essentially what they found in 1832. We found a low stone wall, or remains of a wall, going around the edge of the sea stack. and disappearing off this edge. So clearly the stack was much bigger. And there was an upper terrace and a lower terrace. And this is what we found. We found the remains of a rampart around the edge of the stack. Not much left in terms of the stonework, but you can see there's these hollows. These are for big timbers. And what we found was a timber-laced rampart that surrounded the sea stack. Here's some of the stone facing still in situ there. And we also found in the lower terrace, just down here, which is only about 4 metres across now, evidence for actual buildings on top of this promontory or stack, is it now? Including this fantastic stone-built hearth with in situ floor levels. You can see where the hearth has been raked out in the Pictish period. And these are the dates from the site, just hot off the press. As I'll mention a bit later, in most Pictish forts, if you bring all the dates together, date to the 5th and 6th centuries AD, so in a post-Roman context. What's really exciting about Dunacre is it actually dates to the 3rd and 4th centuries AD. So it's in that late Roman context, exactly the time period when the Romans first start mentioning the Picts and then causing chaos north and south of the frontier. So this seems to be a really early example of the type of site that we know that goes on to underpin kingship. And we don't have any direct dates on the stones, obviously, but it's very interesting that perhaps we have clear evidence for the early dating of the Dunacre symbol stones. So that's Dunacre. Let's quickly move on to Rye. This is a site, one of the sites we've been doing the most work on. We started here in 2012, and the reason we came here, or one of the reasons, was the fantastic place name, which derives from an early Celtic word called Rhi, which is king. And it seems to mean a place associated with a great king. Okay, so a bit of a clue. The archaeology as well is a bit of a clue that something really interesting was going on here, for it's got 8 of these fantastic Pictish stones, including a cross stain up at the top here, which is still standing in a field just to the south of the village of Rhine. And the most famous stone is the Rhine Man, who came from just down slope from where the cross stain stands today. So I don't know if you've all seen this before, but he's got fantastic pointy teeth, and he's carrying this fantastic axe here. And he's now in Aberdeenshire Council headquarters. The other reason we went here is because the cross stain is one of the very few that still stands in its original position. And you can see from these aerial photographs taken by Aberdeenshire Archaeology Service that it stands within an enclosure complex. This is all ploughed away today, so it's all crop mark archaeology, you can see fantastic evidence. And in 2012, we found that essentially the cross stain is standing at the entranceway into a fortified series of enclosures. And so often when we visit Pictish stones today, we imagine them as being isolated in the landscape in these really romantic spots. You can see this was associated with an incredibly busy landscape, including evidence for buildings, rectangular buildings here, perhaps a much bigger building as well, a timber hall even. And you can see the ditches, inner ditch, outer ditch, and on the outside was a big wooden wall that enclosed a little knoll on which the site stands. So quite amazing evidence. So amazing architecture, but also amazing finds. So we began to find fragments of this pottery. Doesn't look like much, but these fragments are from wine amphora coming from the eastern Mediterranean and turning up to Rhine in the 6th century AD. And this stuff is the first finds in the whole of eastern Britain. And the other finds that come from Britain, Ireland, are at high status, usually royal sites. So sites like Clocker in Ireland and Tintagel in southwest England. So amazing stuff coming from eastern Mediterranean. We also found again, these are fragments, but you kind of piece together the evidence from these. This is a shard of glass coming from western France, from drinking beakers, imported again. Very rare stuff, once again. And this is exactly the kind of thing you'd be drinking your wine out of in the 6th century. Also bronze pins. This is a bronze pin, like an Anglo-Saxon examples from high status female graves, brooch pins, dress pins. And also, more excitingly, the evidence for actual production of these kind of objects. So this is a brooch mold, pin mold, and also the actual objects for making these. This is the only known Pictish metalworking tongs, as depicted on that stone I showed you earlier on. This is the X-ray of the tongs there. These are for very fine metalworking. That's a concern. And one of our star finds from 2012 was this fantastic axe-shaped pin. So you can see the axe head here, and the suggestion of some sort of beast on the side here. And what's that like? It's like the axe the Rhine Man carries. So it's amazing, we're starting to find objects that are actually represented on stones. And then you can see the pin conserved, and this is actually a serpent's head. You can see the eye and the snout biting onto the end of the axe. And a quite amazing object, really. It's made of iron as well, which is even more amazing in terms of, this wasn't cast, it was actually hammered out. This year, so I was shooting on, we went back to 2015 and investigated another area of the complex. And this was an area where the Rhine man was found. So that green dot is where the Rhine man was found. And this is the cross stain. And you can see that we thought we might find some sort of entranceway into the fortified complex here. This is our trench. You can see the inner ditch here, the cross stain, the outer ditch, and also the outer wooden wall with all the post holes supporting a huge timber structure on the outside. And the background is tapping off hill floor. Here's a close-up of this feature, sir. And one of the most exciting features we found this year, which is located just here, so right next to the cross stain, and this is the entranceway into the complex, was a stone socket. And you remember from a couple of slides ago, we showed you the picture of where the Rhine man was found. And it's highly likely or highly possible that this is actually where the Rhine man stood, or at least another Pictish symbol stone. So there's a huge pit full of stone packing. And in the bottom of that pit, rather excitingly, was a cattle jaw that had been placed at the bottom of the pit before the standing stone was put in situ. So we've got fantastic dating material for the socket, so we'll be able to directly date putting up of this stone, and also probably its destruction as well. You can see it's full destruction layers on top of that standing stone socket. So this is where we think the Rhine man might stood, or at least one of the other symbol stones, and that made us go a bit crazy. So no expense spare from my knowledge. We also had lots of nice finds again. This is Tessa from Glasgow, who's been mentioned quite a lot. I came up on her couple of days off to do some digging, and I found one of our nicest artifacts, which is a stick pin, a dress pin, with a fantastic blue bead as well. And lots more shards of this Mediterranean amphora. And also a couple of other shards that are probably coming from Spain or North Africa. So incredible connections at this site. We had a fantastic community engagement. We've got a local group who's called the Rhine Women, who are an artistic collective, and they do things like pop-up coffee shops. We've been replicating some artifacts to engage with people. The Rhine man here, some our axe pins. This is our Pictish coffee shop this year, and also activities for the kids as well. These are all the dates for Rhine. Essentially, it seems to date from 450 to 550 AD. So in that immediate post-Roman context, which ties in really well with evidence from other Pictish sites, which seem to date to that 5th and 6th century watershed transformation, the Dunacre, that slightly earlier phase, so that's 400 and that's 600, you can see they're all dating to that time period. And what seems to happen is that smaller sites, like Rhine and Dunacre, seem to go out of use quite early on, but some of the bigger sites continue right through almost to the 9th or 10th century AD. So it looks like you've got lots of sites emerging in that post-Roman context, but only some are successful and keep on going through the early medieval period. Parallels for Rhine, there's not many, but this is a fantastic one. This is Kuningsborough in Shetland, which in Old Norse means the king's fort. And lo and behold, what have you got at this site? You've got a Nord depiction of someone carrying an axe here. And I think the cult dimension of these characters is underlined by this other depiction from Papal in Shetland, where you've got these people. The Rhine man has always been, a number of people suggest he's wearing a mask. I think it's unlikely when you see these other people who are clearly half human, half animal. They've got like seagull legs here and human heads. It's probably to do with pagan kingship and the sacral nature of that in that early phase here. So here's the Rhine man standing at the entranceway to that fortified complex. The third site and last site I'd like to briefly mention today is Burgh Head. And Burgh Head is one of those forts that go on right through into the 9th and 10th centuries AD. So it's a very successful site clearly. And it's three times the size of any other early medieval fort in Scotland. So it's clearly one of the key centres of that kingdom of Fortune. So it's in Murray. Unfortunately, it was trashed quite substantially in the 19th century. The building of the new town in 1805, but that led to some fantastic discoveries, including 30 carvings of bulls coming from probably the early phases of the fort, and also some Christian sculptures as well, suggesting again the significance and perhaps the sacred dimensions of this site goes on through towards the end of the first millennium AD. So we went to do some work there last year. I think there's always been the perception that there was likely to be nothing surviving at Burghead because of the later destruction of the fort. What we found digging in the Coast Guard station houses towards the end in Upper Citadel is that, yes, there is lots of 19th century disturbance, but there's clearly lots of in-situ archaeology as well. So this is just a small trench, 4 by 2 metres. Here we found a destroyed building of some kind with postals, so timber structure within the fort. And right next to it, just in this little tiny test bit we dug here, we found an animal bone midden that went down for 1.5 metres, absolutely packed full of cattle bone, which is quite interesting in terms of depiction of bulls at Burghead. And you can also see things like quern stones, etc. as well. What we also spotted on the outside rampart was actually a section of the outer rampart wall, which is peeking out due to there's a little footpath that comes down here and it's eroded away this. And we just dated a nice organic layer underneath the outer rampart wall. So we're dating the old grout surface, which dates to probably the 4th century, so the rampart must be later than that, so it's 5th century or later. So again, it falls into that 5th century context. And we also dated one of the postals from that timber building, dating to probably the 6th century AD, and the midden dates to probably the 9th or 10th century AD, so right to the end of the use of that fort. And within that animal bone midden, we found a fragment of an Anglo-Saxon coin from Alfred the Great, and it's been pierced for wearing. So fantastic evidence, and just shows you what might be found at Burghead over the coming years. So we're going back this year to look at the site again. So almost finished. This is Gold Cross, another site we've worked on. We found a silver hoard there. Well, we don't have time to tell you about that, so you'll have to invite me back again to talk more about this. Richard briefly mentioned this. This is probably dating to the 6th or 7th century AD, full of late Roman material and also penile brooches and all sorts of material we found next to a stone circle, which is quite interesting. So if you want to find out more about the project, our partners are the Tarbert Discovery Centre up in the Tarbert Peninsula. These little museums are really struggling at the moment, so please go and visit. And we have lots of community events associated with our project. Least of all, the Riding Woman events, and you know, we've been on the TV and stuff like that. My wife says he's never off the telly. We're also doing a bit of crowdfunding, so that's a cheeky reference here. If anyone has got a few pennies to spare, you can always help us out to do more work as part of Northern Picts. Anyway, thank you very much for listening. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Thanks.